Well, welcome everybody. Welcome to Caffeinated Mornings. Lots of new faces here. Thanks for showing up. I'm Jay Farrakane. We've been doing Caffeinated off and on because of COVID for almost 8 years now. It seems crazy. Just so those of you don't know where you're standing right now, you're actually technically on the CU campus. This is a grad school called the Studio at CMCI. It's kind of a next step in between traditional design and product making. And if there's any CMC, are there any CMCI folks here right now? Maybe not. Well, anyway, if you want to know more, check, oh, there we go, back there. Feel free to grab some folks and ask questions. Where am I? So I'm Jay Farrakane. I run my own small design consultancy called Angry Bovine. I started Caffeinated Morning a number of years ago simply for the fact that I felt like the town needed a rally point and for creatives to get together. And so here we are a number of years later and get to meet awesome people like Joey and have all you folks here. And hopefully you'll get to introduce yourselves to other people and we keep this creative community going. We can't do this without lots and lots of sponsors. TDA here really has backed us since day one. Thanks to Josh at the Coffee Ride. He's somewhere, I saw him. There he is back there. He keeps us fueled. To Ryan and the crew at Buck Ross for filming this. You can always check us out on Vimeo and YouTube. So give us check-ins and follows there. Month of Modern, Pro Photo Rental gives us all our gear. Snappy Little Numbers, this is how we know we hit the big time because we actually have our own official theme track now from Chuck at Snappy Little Numbers, and I don't get my Instagram posts pulled down anymore. And then our newest supporter, City of Boulder Office and Culture, Arts and Culture. And that gets that all out of the way. So hi, Joey.
Hello.
Welcome. 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 So for those of you that don't know Joey, adventure athlete, photographer, I think that you're all here because you know who he is and what he does. Cinematographer, director. You know, Joey is funny because he's, you know, a world-class level mountain biker, filmer, business person, editor, doer of all. And now, like, you know, also one of the really nicest humans I've met in a long time. So thanks for being here. I knew of your work well before Thomas. Where's Thomas? Thomas Woodson's in here somewhere. Oh, there he is, he's hiding. Before Thomas introduced you over my fence and you guys were filming on the road in front of my place. And I think my dogs were going crazy. And I'm like, dude, who do I have to go up there and like shoot? And So anyway, Thomas, by the way, who I've known for years and is a Caffeinated alumni. And you know, I call that like Thomas 1.0 phase there. And people have suggested you as a guest for a really long time and COVID's and all that stuff has gotten here. So anyway, we're finally here and super stoked. I actually knew you for this image, I think, way before we ever chatted. And it was funny because I think when I first saw this, there was like people, like drop bar people talking about this. Like not even just like mountain bikers, like skinny pants, Lycra cyclists were like, dude, did you see that picture? And blah, blah. And I think it was really interesting because, you know, we got to do a little talking in the lead up to this. And, you know, I think if I was to ask you if there was one phrase to describe you or your approach to work, what would that be?
I'd say my approach to work has always just been like, go all in. Like just kind of the circumstance of how I got into filmmaking and photography was just inherently like all in. So that's just kind of been the motto ever since.
Your background in, and I don't want to dismiss the level of racing you were doing. So downhill mountain biking, World Cup stuff, ripping local trails here for years and beyond too, like, you know, all over the United States. But your mental state for that was pretty high level, like all in on that as well, right?
Yeah.
How do you make the transition from, and for you it was pretty particular, making that transition from I'm a competitive racer and now it's time to like maybe think about doing some other stuff. It wasn't that like pause. There were some forcing functions in that kind of like drove you to making some of your next steps.
Totally. Well, I think from like age like 13 on, it was just like, I want to be the best mountain biker in the world. And, you know, things kind of pan out. You get up to a pretty high level, but I'm like, well, maybe I don't want to be the best mountain biker in the world, but you still have all this like energy and drive and like motivation, and you need to like put that energy into something. And then that's kind of when I found filmmaking was just like, well, if I do that same amount of effort into this, like I could go here.
And right.
You kind of just weave the path of your life the way you see it coming together. And it's not like It's not like you're just totally giving up on that dream. You're just kind of like,
well, I think you did that sweet intensity. Spot. You did that sweet spot of like figuring out like, man, I really like these parts of this thing.
Yeah.
And so like, what can we do elsewhere? But you also had the fire in your life too, right? Like,
yeah.
So you're in school and then all of a sudden you're kind of like making some decisions on racing, but then you also have like, you know, we have a lot of like climactic change happening here, right? Like floods and fires, it's biblical shit going on right now.
Yeah.
But one of those hit you pretty hard and your family. And yeah. So it kind of like led you to some opportunity, right? Like,
totally. Yeah.
Want to talk a little bit about.
I guess at the time I was like racing World Cup mountain biking and going to see you at the same time in the advertising program. And that's when the 4 Mile fire happened, and I was living at my parents' house in 4 Mile, and we lost everything. And the University of Colorado gave me $10,000 in like some disaster fund that they had. And then the Red Cross gave me like $4,000 that I had to spend in 24 hours. And I was like, well, shit, like I've always wanted to like get into filmmaking. This seems like a good time to do like a pretty heavy pivot. And it was just like, spent $14,000 on camera gear and was like, I guess I'm gonna do this. And
was it a guess or was it a fairly clear?
No, it was super clear.
Okay,
it was
cool.
Like yeah. Kind of a guess of like how to get started. And that's like kind of where the personal projects things come in. It's like, I feel like anytime you want to reinvent yourself as a filmmaker, you just need to like make some projects for yourself, show that you can do them, and then people will start hiring you for that type of work.
Well, and that was such an interesting thing that, you know, you leading up to this, well before the mountain bike stuff, you know, even you and your crew of mountain bikers filming each other like on local trails, the sledding video was like part of your early DNA.
Totally.
Too.
And I think that's part about being an athlete is like, there's always like, you want to see what it looks like and like share it with people, especially extreme sports. Like most people aren't there watching. So
right.
It's like, that's inherently part of the culture. But as a kid growing up in 4 Mile, like my dad got this like DV cam from one of his clients and like I would do 2 hours of yard work for 30 minutes of film time and he would like film and commentate us sledding. So that was kind of like the start of like, oh, like filming.
That's
is
awesome.
Like kind of a part of the culture of the sport.
Yeah. That, it's interesting to think about the documentation of it too, because now that you, it's been, you know, as somebody who's raced and stuff like that, it is an interesting thing to think about, hey, do I want to stop this long enough to capture it? And then there is that shift of like, do you ever get into a point where you're like out filming and you're like watching someone like shred it? And then you're like, fuck, I wish I was riding right now.
Oh, for sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was hoping
and
that
think,
was still
like
there.
Thomas and I talk about this a lot as like, you know, partners in a lot of projects and Ben as well. Like, you know, sometimes we just have to be, hey, we're not filming today. Like,
good.
We're not taking photos today. Like, we went skiing in Japan and we didn't take a single photo.
That's awesome.
Well, so it's important, especially the longer you do it, to like be able to draw those lines and know when you're working and when you're not.
Well, there was a clarity when we got to talk in the lead up to this that, you know, you make, I think of one of the challenges for a lot of creatives today is like, how do we carve out that space for ourselves? And you're pretty disciplined about that. I wonder if it's tied back to racing and stuff like that, that you just set these boundaries and you're like, we're not going to do it. Because it's easy to be in this slippery slope of like, I'm just going to keep working or
totally.
Doing things I don't really
yeah.
want to do. And, it, you know, the more creatives I talk to, there is often this theme of, hey, something presented itself. And the creatives that I know that are like, oh, you got somewhere. It's because you recognize it and you like took advantage of it. So one of the things that, you know, you had the opportunity to work at Yeti. And then, you know, the advent of the internet changing and things like that, it kind of progressed you through a series of roles. I want to talk a little bit about, you know, that kind of like little things showing up in your path and you're like,
yeah,
you know, that's an opportunity.
Totally. Well, I found out pretty quickly racing bikes, it's hard to make like a real career and make any money. So I started working at Yeti kind of randomly, like had been on the race team for a number of years. And it was right when like social media was starting. Instagram and Twitter and Facebook. And I just like one day started all the brand's accounts and was like, yeah, so it's kind of a job and you should probably
put me on the
payroll.
You went to the CEO and said this, right?
Yeah, to the owner. He's like, you're not wrong and we do need someone to do it. So that sounds like a deal.
I think a lot of times like creatives are fearful of like creating their own roles, especially now we see a lot of creatives go to work in brands, right?
Yeah.
Like less agencies and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I've heard it from a lot of them. Like, I don't fit this sweet spot, but you did that thing where you're like, well, guess what? I've been doing this thing and it should be a job now.
Totally.
Yeah.
And then I think 6 months later, I was more like, well, it's really more of like a photography job than like the social media. And I think like another 6 months later, Chris Conroy, the owner of Yeti, was like, you're figuring it out. Like, I think you should go out on your own and like, we'll hire you and be your main client, but like, you should go explore more.
I think that's a really good sign of a manager too. You know, like as creatives out there, like picking jobs and stuff, if you don't have someone who's kind of leaving the door open a little bit or encouraging you to do something beyond what you were hired for, that's a signal too. Well, it was, you know, when we were talking about like, hey, what do you want to share? And one of your first pieces of work, like when we were talking about, you know, what we could work through, it was interesting because you're like, hey, I had this piece. I did it like a number of years ago. First official Yeti piece?
I'd worked on other Yeti pieces, but this piece is kind of interesting because it's like kind of set the benchmark of what, as Yeti looks back through their like Vimeo, YouTube, like what they like keep up and delete. It's like the first one that they've like haven't deleted. So it kind of felt like at the time, like this was the first job that like Thomas and I went on together that were like, damn, this is actually kind of like a career and like we can do more than just the adventure films and like make money doing this.
Yeah, and it's cool. And I think that when it was really interesting when you said, hey, this is the one I want to share. And then I watched it, I could kind of see the takeaway why, but let's all watch it.
Crest Butte's an amazing place. I have high peaks, huge groves of aspens, and just great single track everywhere you look.
After a long, hot summer, it's really nice when fall rolls around. Trail conditions are perfect. It's cooler.
Feeling like I've ridden a lot in Colorado, it's just refreshing to know that there's so much more riding to be had and to go explore.
It's great to get one really good week before winter comes. And a lot of the other people clear out, so you get the whole place to yourself. It's the best time of the year.
Lose touch with reality a bit and just get to hang out with friends and ride bikes all day. And everything kind of slows down and just a blast.
That we were able to pull this trip together and get some really good riding in.
There is no question, mama.
see, it makes you want to go ride.
But yeah, that piece was interesting because it felt like the first thing that we made that had like a logo at the end.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, and it's interesting because, you know, you said it was like your crossover really from like personal work into commercial work. And it does all the stuff that a branded kind of piece should. But I don't know, maybe it was your youthfulness or you coming out of more. But it has that vibe of like purity of like, no, dude, I'm stoked on writing. Too,
totally.
You know. It's such an interesting thing, yeah, to be able to watch that. And there is like, you know, the textures and stuff that you start getting in that as you build through, like, yeah, you got to balance all the things of having like brand pieces in there, right? But like you still had those textures and things that you're probably like, as a mountain biker, this is what I really see. And I think even back paired back to your racing, you know, knowing where lines are going to be and that kind of stuff. Living in the woods forever too has given you some of those cues that where you can do this texture stuff. So, well, and you know, I think one of the interesting things that we got to talk about in leading up to this is that, you know, a lot of people know you for this kind of stuff, commercial, like free riding and adventures and that kind of stuff. But my friend who is a tattooer, he says sometimes we make art and sometimes we make money. And I always kind of like think back to this, not that you're doing ever work that you're like, ah, shit, I'm just getting paid to do this. But there is an effort of like, I have to switch gears now and this might not be about me or something like that. Is there a challenge in kind of approaching that work? Or do you feel like you just slide right into it the same way you would tackle a trip to South America for yourselves or your crew?
I mean, I think it is an important thing to learn. I've definitely had like younger people that I've worked with that have this like, you can like see them have this realization that it's not like just banger project after banger project like yeah, all the time. Like sometimes you do have to show up and just like cam op and like that's it. And
right,
it's just, you know, it's a job, you do your best. It's not like not enjoyable, but it's not like your like brainchild.
Yeah.
But I think having parents that were both, you know, kind of creative, like my mom is an interior designer, my dad's an architect, like just seeing them like in like growing up, you kind of also like realize like, oh, like of course I'm going to work for myself someday and not with a company, because that's the way you do it and that's the way to freedom. And
well, it was never in your plan, right? Like to like go work somewhere. It's almost like this thing is just kind of unfolded in
totally
front of you and taking advantage of it. So I wanted to show a little example of some commercial work that you had done here. And I think the interesting thing that you've done that came out of all these opportunities that presented themselves, and we haven't talked at all really about this, is yeah, it's one thing that you're ready to rock and roll and show up and do a great job, but you also have the equipment. Like you've invested heavily in the equipment. And I don't know if you guys, I got invited up to Joey's spot, and if you haven't, I apologize, but he might be nice enough. It's rad. It's super cool. It's like the creative like launch pad to go out and just like tackle any film project. And I think that's one of your sweet spots too, is that you've built this gear arsenal, you've built your team, and now you can kind of go out and really tackle anything and maybe give a little setup on what we're
totally
about to see
here. Yeah, like I feel like if you looked at my Instagram or Vimeo, like you would never know that I do this kind of stuff too.
Right.
But this is like a scenario where like a larger production company in LA couldn't get a drone permit for
we're gonna get one over.
Couldn't get a drone permit for flying over the Venice skate park for this Pacifico commercial. And so they called me panicking, asking if I could set up a cable cam over the Venice skate park, because they could get permits for that, but not for a drone. So I showed up and we had like one day to make it work, and we're driving cherry pickers around through the sand, like putting down plywood boards to keep and getting them stuck. Like everyone's pushing them. Finally got two cherry pickers set up and the cable cam strung over, and then it's like 100 people watching you operate this thing.
Well, and it's not a small brand,
no,
either, right?
But it is insane. You watch this, you're like, oh, that's pretty simple. It's like, no, there was 100 people there, and there's probably who knows how many thousands of emails sent around this job for like this thing that looks so simple. And I think the whole ad's like 5 shots, and I was literally there just for 1 shot.
And that is, you know, that's two things. One, from the time that you got the phone call to the time that you were pushing boards around in the sand, what's the time frame?
It was like 12 hours. I went the next morning.
No shit.
Yeah. So it was definitely like a fix this problem.
Yeah.
But to be able to do that for like a large production company and like come out from Colorado to LA.
Yeah.
Like usually the calls go in the other way.
Yeah, totally.
Like people are leaving LA to go work elsewhere.
Do you ever feel like sometimes, as you know, creatives, I always say that we're in a service industry. You and I had this discussion. And it was interesting to think about, like, in some way, being able to react like that. do we turn ourselves into enablers though, right? Like then all of a sudden, like agencies are like, hey man, like we called you like last time, we're gonna give you 4 hours to get here. Yeah. Like, you know, has that ever happened? Like where they keep squeezing it down
on
you?
If they're panicked, that's great. I mean, that's just, the price tag is reflected
in the
amount of panic.
Sliding skull,
Well, there I don't care about the Pacifico ad.
I think there's two things that happen in that. It's smart of you to look at it that way. Yeah, you can charge what you kind of need to, right?
Yeah.
Because they need you. But also, there's something wonderful about done. Like I've become a fan of done lately. Like, hey, you gave us this limited time frame. We can go and do it longer, but would it be any better? Who knows?
Totally. No, it's kind of fun, honestly. I kind of like the like quickness you have to have.
Yeah.
And that also lends like to having your own gear. It's like someone calls me tomorrow, like the three of us are out there doing it.
Yeah.
Like no problem.
Well, and it's interesting too to think about, like, you know, you said this is one in a series of other things, and that's what a lot of production ends up being like too. I guess that's the step over too, right? You don't come off as like having a giant ego or anything like that, but a lot of times some directors are like, hey, if I'm not the showcase, or this is literally about me. And I think that to me is almost where it starts to slide back into, you take some of your projects like a designer would. There's a subjectivity, there's an objectivity to it. You kind of, it isn't an, I woke up this morning feeling like this. It was more of like, hey, we had a job to do. And this
totally.
Is,
and I think that's the cool part about working for yourself in this industry is that some days you get to be like the cool director, like running the show. And some days you're just like setting up a cable cam and there's like, you know, no one knows your name. And it's just like this, like you kind of fly off the radar sort of thing. And it's like every job you're just kind of in a different role. And it's super fun to like some weeks kind of just blend in and some weeks kind of get to take over and control it a bit more.
That's nice. You do seem to have that want to like keep it mixed up.
Yeah.
Pacifica was proof for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
But yeah, it's really that simple. Like that's probably like a, I don't know, just so much panic to make that.
Well, and it is, it's an interesting thing, right? Too, when we think about like sometimes, I remember I had a friend in the ad world and he was like, you know, I started having these judgments of like, you know, I worked 4 months out of my life and I missed seeing the birth of my child and, you know, for a Burger King ad. And he was like, I had to change some stuff.
Totally.
But in these kind of situations, it is it's a contribution too, right? You know, so.
Totally.
One of the things I thought was really interesting when we kind of did the lead up and the talk here, you were you said, I'm super stoked I never built a company. I think I'm probably screwing that up, but I'm going to paraphrase it into that.
Oh, yeah, that's it.
And it was really interesting because, like, you know, I think what you have done is you built a name. And there is a subtle difference in it, right? It's more of reputation versus, like, oh, there's this physical entity somewhere in a city or something like that. Do you feel that you like purposely worked towards that arrival, or was it more of like it just flowed?
I feel like it was kind of a discovery. Like I met Thomas Woodson like 10 years ago, more or less, when he moved to Boulder. And then more recently, our friend Ben. And I'd say the three of us probably do 70% of our work together, a fair bit.
Yeah.
And like we definitely discussed starting a company and making a brand. And like it's like a little like, you know, like studio house sort of thing, like collective, whatever you want to call it. But the longer we didn't do it, the more we realized it's kind of a sweet way to go. Like we've never not been like busy since we started, so that's like part of it. But also it's just like once you create a company, you have to have a building and an overhead and all this stuff, and I feel like we're just busy working. And we're not doing any of that stuff. And when we're not working, we can invest.
You don't want to be working.
We can invest that free time in our personal lives.
Yeah.
And not into like feeding this like machine more and more and more and more.
Well, your adaptable model too, I think, is what a lot of like crews are starting to do these days. And it is interesting too to think, you know, like the effort of putting it into a building and a brand and that kind of stuff, whether it's a conventionalized trick that the business world tells us, hey, you're not successful unless you have this. I think defying that in a weird way is like, not even a weird way, in a great way, that it's the way of the future, actually. Why invest in all that when it could be put back into equipment and doing a better job and taking more time?
And I don't think like we're ever gonna get the like Pacifico job because the agency wants like a big company to do it, but like we might get still hired onto that. And it allows you to be hired by like a lot of different creative, like a lot of different production companies. Mm-hmm. And then also kind of be functioning as your own too.
Yeah.
So it just gives you a lot more opportunities. Like, I don't think like too often, like a director from one production company is going to get hired by another production company.
But yeah,
like,
that's
in our scenario, it kind of lets us do that.
Right. Well, and it is an interesting way to think about it, because not that you're brandless, but like you are more of a, like a neutral entity in it. So yeah. It probably does allow you to like slot in easier.
Yeah. And that kind of stuff. And I think it's nice for brands too. I feel like Getty's like, oh, we want Joey and Thomas. And then Atomic's like, oh, we want Ben, Joey, and Thomas. Mm-hmm. And it's like, they can kind of like a la carte, like build out these teams. And it's like, we can be pretty confident that we have the best team for the job. It's like, we can kind of match our skills. And especially when it's like outdoor adventure stuff, it's like, half the battle sometimes is like having the actual skill set to do the thing, whether it's climbing or skiing or navigating avalanche terrain while also carrying a red. And
yeah,
it's like, it's a lot more than just like being in a studio.
Well, on that note, you know, you guys, we didn't get to talk about it, and there's no big parking spot in this discussion for it. But one of the things that I think was really interesting about your kind of getting started was Hawaii Wash. I always say that wrong. And I think that was kind of like knowing Joey and a lot of that. I think you guys set this new precedent in a number of ways on that. Number one, it was like kind of venturing out into territory, no guides, but who cares? We'll get it figured out. Like that kind of like, we'll do it ourselves. But even the way that manifested now, I think it's somewhat of a programmatic way that brands release content, right? Like you built a website, there was films associated with it. But again, the bigger story, all of that is like there was no guide and no fixed way to do anything. You know, and so like it's kind of interesting to hear you talk about that, and it, the crew is really at the heart of all that for you guys.
Totally.
I think one of the most unique things about the creative scene here in the Front Range, and I was actually just talking to somebody about this morning, is that it is super connected. You were mentioning like, dude, I've only lived in the city of Boulder for how many years?
2 years.
2 years, but been here 32.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Born in Boulder, but never lived in the city.
And it's interesting, you were saying that you felt like more connected to the outdoor industry than the creative community, or did I have that right? More?
I feel like most of the work we do is kind of in this like broader outdoor industry. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, you know, that's why things like Caffeinated Mornings is cool, is because it is a little bit of a community. I probably should have been coming to these the last 8 years. But,
well, now that you know, you'll be here. But it is, that was one reason that we kind of built this, was to build on this. It is a very unique place, the Front Range, because like you'll meet people and it's very collaborative and there's so much talent availability here too, right? Like people move here because it's awesome and
yeah. You
can do the things you want, but you also are really good at your job. And I think it's a very rare combo. So I think things like this, if you guys meet other people today, connect with them so that you can kind of keep this going. But it's important, you know, because I know that you, and we're gonna talk about your latest project with, it's Ben too on this, right?
Thomas.
And then, because without, you know, all your equipment and the right crew, you know, you're not going to be able to do these things. It would be really hard as just Joey, right?
Yeah.
Even though I think a lot of people are like, oh, you know, it's just, you know, it's just you. So we're going to jump into this. It's a premiere, dude. Worldwide.
It might be the Boulder premiere.
We're going to jump into this really quick. But I think this was a really interesting piece to share, because it felt like
it was a lot different than the other two.
Such a moment. And Preston, if you can watch audio on this one when we get going. Good job, buddy. And in some ways, you know, when I watched that piece a few times, and it was really interesting because I, you know, having known about your personal work and stuff, it seemed somewhat reminiscent. I don't know if you feel the same, but like Hawaii Wash or however you say that word, and then this like big evolution into something completely new, but they're super related because it's a narrative, foreign, but then also like this journey of like fun and discovery and things like that. Did you see it in any of the same way, or how do you sell through an idea like this?
I mean, Thomas had done like a tempo one before, so we're kind of building off that idea. And I think the more you do filmmaking, the more you're trying to look to get into something different, keep it interesting,
right. Keep
it fun. And I feel like every couple years we come across a project where I guess when you own your own gear, you can like invest more, like you can sponsor it too and invest an extra week or something. And like in this instance, like Thomas invested like a, probably an extra month of editing that like wasn't really paid for, but it's like,
right.
You can kind of do these projects to like level up. And like in the case of Ben and I, we did a film on Nepal's fastest mountain biker a couple years ago. And like we went for a month when we had the budget for like 2 weeks and edited for 3 months instead of editing for 1 month, which would have been like the reasonable thing to do. So I feel like every couple years we're like doing these projects where we're like pushing ourselves beyond what's expected from the sponsors to kind of like level up, I guess. So this was definitely one of those, and like working with Thomas on things like this is super fun because I feel like we'll go out and shoot and it's almost like this like call and response thing. Like I'll be on the gimbal trying like a very different type of shot, and I'll like heat up like 3 shots. I'm like, you take them. Like, and then like, I'll take like a 10-minute break and then like think of something else while he's doing like the shaky cam stuff.
Right.
It's like, we're shooting like such opposite styles. And then like in the edit, you weave them together. And it's like, if you had one camera, you would never do that. Like you would never be switching from the gimbal. You would spend all day
switching gear,
like bits.
Well, and that affordability, there is something funny that I remember working for a guy who's like, never do any free work. And it didn't mean, don't do anything like where you're not paid. But what he meant was is always figure out where the value is if you're working for like less than your rate, right? And for you guys to be in like doing that investment, that's like, it's so interesting. Like, hey, we've got this opportunity. Why not? That's not a common thing that you see in like, you know, creative today, like pushing yourself.
Totally.
Do you guys see it as an evolution for the way you want to make movies maybe in the future or make content?
I mean, if we could make them all like this, it's pretty damn fun.
At least right now.
No client. Like, yeah. It's like, well, who is the DP? It was like, well, Thomas was the shaky DP and I was the gimbal DP. Like, I don't know.
Yeah.
Like, we all just kind of figure it out. And like, people are like, well, you need these like strict roles. It's like the three of us, like, we'll be like just switching through who's director hour to hour. And then everyone's just performing at their peak mental bandwidth for that hour. Kind of just works.
That kind of like threshold, you know, interval training, maybe again, your athlete background's showing up in you guys. But, you know, I think every once in a while, you'll like, as a designer, we get to ask ourselves these questions, creatives, filmmakers, whatever it is. And I've kind of lumped it into this world of like creative maturity. And I do not think of myself as a very mature human being. Like I laugh at, you know, potty words and stuff like that. So, but there is a point in your work where you've been doing it long enough that sometimes you can't articulate it, but you're arriving at these new things, and let's just call it creative maturity. Do you think that that's something that you kind of like with this effort, you're consciously working to achieve? Or is it like, no man, that's just the next step. It's the natural evolution of things.
I think it's just the natural evolution. Like, I think being a creative, like inherently you're just trying to find something that satiates you.
Right.
And the same thing stops satiating you over and over. So you just naturally are like
make new,
slowly evolving.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, it feels natural. I don't feel like we're like one day, like let's make something like super different.
Yeah. Well, and it's funny in the filmmaking world, right? Like you talk about spending an extra month on an edit or something like that. A lot of times, a lot of creatives I've talked to, one of the major values of a project is finishing the project. Fuck, it's done. But that resolve is so long for you guys.
Yeah.
Is that still a treasure in the creative process for you? It's done?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Oh yeah. It's what makes us wish we were photographers sometimes. Cause like,
yeah,
we all kind of started doing more photo in the beginning.
Yeah.
And it was just like, okay, boom, that job's done. This job's done. This job's done. Like you take on something like this, it's like, you don't need to just get one good shot. Like you're a little more stressed the whole project. Cause it's like everything has to come together. It's like way more moving pieces.
And something like that, are you both working on sound design of something so critically tied like this between?
Well, luckily on this one, like Kyle,
okay.
His whole degree was in music. Like Thomas could speak to it more, but like he actually did the mix on it
okay.
and stuff. So
yeah,
it's just, yeah, working with other.
It's an interesting example too, because of the sheer, it's a little chicken and egg, right? Like. The soundtrack came out of the action of doing the thing, but it's woven back into the thing. So it was kind of an interesting take. If there was one thing you wish you knew when you got started in this whole weird thing that you're doing now, that you know now, what would it be?
I don't know. I honestly wouldn't really change it. It's like the whole discovery's just been fun.
Is there been any like major screw-ups that you're like, shit, how am I gonna recover from that?
Not really. Like, we've definitely burned some cameras pretty bad, crashed them into trees and stuff. But other than that, it's like, no. Like, I mean, some projects hit harder than others, and it's just, you never really know until you do it, so.
I think it was really interesting, and this maybe back to the creative maturity thing, but you really are, I think it's admirable about the way that you kind of carve out time to not work. And so, but you didn't have to build that in. Was there ever a period where you're like, I'm working too much right now?
For sure, yeah. Like, there was definitely a time where like, I would just work till 10 every night.
Yeah.
And like get going at like 8, and it was just like 7 days a week. But now, like, I probably take 4 months off a year.
That's cool.
And someone asked me to go float the Grand Canyon. I'm like, hell yeah, I'm there.
Nice.
And so, yeah, I think you just get to a point where you're like, I do have clients. I do get phone calls. Like, I can take this time off. Like, if I don't, I will burn out. And like, I don't know. I think we've all kind of discovered that together.
It is. I think it's such a, whether it was the pandemic or whatever, but I do think that we've been presented this really interesting opportunity where it's okay for creatives to do this kind of stuff. Because there was this world of, your reputation was so heavily built on the last thing you did that if you weren't doing more things to follow it, like a domino set, you know, you're kind of
totally
like out there.
Well, like, yeah. And like creativity isn't like an endless tap either. Like your work just starts to suffer and everything you do is not as good.
Yeah.
But if you can like find a bit of boredom, then you're just like motivated to create something awesome like that. Like you need to find a bit of boredom to be creative.
Right, you need that anxiety or the anxious energy to kind totally. Of like, I wanna get out and go do stuff.
And like there are people that are just machines doing projects 12 months out of the year.
Tory.
But like, I just don't wanna be that.
Yeah. What is next for you? What's the next big project?
Thomas and Ben and I have another film that we shot in Italy last summer. Sweet. That we're currently editing. So that's kind of the big push right now. And just kind of cruising this year.
Good.
So.
Well, you're doing it well. Yeah, and I really appreciate the time and you getting out here and finally putting this together, man. Thanks so much.
No, thank you. Yeah.
You guys can learn more about... learn more about Joey at Joey Schusler. All the at Joey Schuslers will get you there. This is a first Friday event. So every month we're here in this building doing something like this with awesome people just like Joey. Next month we'll be back with Dan Lehman, who's a illustrator and graphic designer here in Boulder, done lots and lots of rad work. You will know his stuff when you see him. So please come back, join us for that. Check us out on YouTube and Vimeo. If you've missed any of our past talks, they're pretty easy to find. And you can always give us a follow at Caffeinated. That is where we tell people who's coming up and like what's next. So again, thank you all for coming. It was awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
See you next time.
Yeah, that was rad.
Cool. Super.